What is the difference between a reptile and an amphibian?
So the difference between reptiles and amphibians are reptiles have got scales and a dry skin. They lay hard-shelled eggs, but they have a backbone. And amphibians have moist, usually smooth skin. There's no scales on them, and they don't have hard-shelled eggs, but they do have also a backbone. And both groups have got, you know, eyes and a mouth, but some of them look rather strange, like some of the elongated forms, like caecilians. There are amphibians, other burrowing skinks, and of course snakes are very elongate without legs. So some of the species have got legs, and some have actually lost them.
How many kinds of reptiles and amphibians live in Cuba?
There are a big diversity of reptiles and amphibians in Cuba. And with the amphibians, there are currently 67 species that are described, but we know that there are going to be a lot more frogs still to be discovered in Cuba. All the species in Cuba are frogs that are amphibians. We don't see examples of salamanders or caecilians there. And with the reptiles, there are currently about 147 species or 149 species of reptiles that have been recorded in Cuba. And they include things like lizards and snakes. There is an aquatic turtle there, for example. And they also have marine turtles. But again, just like the amphibians, we expect that number to continue to increase as more research work discovers yet more new species.
What do you find most interesting about Cuba's reptiles and amphibians?
So when I go to Cuba and I see these reptiles and amphibians, I think the first thing that I really love is that many of them are found only in Cuba, and they've adapted to very special conditions. So for example, there's this group of lizards called anoles, and they have these big dewlap skin on their underside of their neck. But these lizards are really cool because they live in all sorts of different types of habitats. So you can find them on walls of buildings and on tree trunks and up high in the tops of bigs of trees. You can find them in caves, you can find them on the grasslands, and you can even find them on the edges of riverbanks. They're able to partly swim. So it's a great example of seeing how, you know, these lizards got into Cuba and then have what we call adapted. They've become specialists, where they've actually sort of found all these special areas in Cuba that where they can live.
What are some of the biggest and smallest reptiles and amphibians in Cuba?
So some of the smallest reptiles in Cuba are they have these tiny geckos, and they're not much bigger than a fingernail. You find them in leaf litter. Sometimes they have a little white spot on the end of their tail. But they're adapted for living amongst leaf litter, and when you first see them, you might think it's even an insect which is running around. The largest reptiles in Cuba would be things like the sea turtles, where some of the species that nest these females when they come onto the beaches are you know, more than 100 pounds in weight. And in terms of the species that are found on the ground in Cuba, one of the species that I came across that seemed to me particularly spectacular was the Cuban boa. And this is a snake which can get maybe as thick as your forearm, perhaps 5-6 feet in length. And but they're impressive animals, and also very docile. You can pick them up in the wild, and they're very chill about it.
Where do reptiles and amphibians live in Cuba?
So reptiles and amphibians in Cuba, they live pretty much everywhere, which is kind of cool. So you can be in towns, and you can find things like Cuban tree frogs living in gardens. And these are actually quite toxic large tree frogs. They're very beautiful. I think they're actually very pretty frogs. But you can also find amphibians in Cuba pretty much everywhere. So in caves, rivers and streams, deep in rainforests, and also some species that are adapted to dry conditions. And the same is true for the reptiles. The reptiles as well are found throughout the island. One of the other large reptiles you get is this amazing Cuban rock iguana, which is this big black-colored lizard, which gets to about like 3 or 4 feet long and looks really like a mini dinosaur. But you find that on the coastline.
What is your favorite reptile or amphibian in Cuba?
So my favorite reptile or amphibian in Cuba, I guess I would say I have two. For a reptile, my favorite reptile is a crown night anole, which is a green lizard. But it's called a crown anole because it lives up in the crowns and the very tops of trees. And it gets to maybe like about 2 feet, 2.5 feet in length, but it has these lovely scales and beautiful markings on its head. It's a very beautiful animal, and it's really adapted for living at the tops of trees. And the other species that I particularly like is Cuba has the second smallest frog in the world, which is this tiny little Fotostock frog. And it's not much bigger than the pencil lead on a pencil. And it's black with these little yellow stripes that occurs in the leaf litter. But the first time I found those frogs, it was just amazing to see. It looked like a little insect.
How does fieldwork help you understand Cuba's reptiles and amphibians?
So fieldworking in Cuba really helps us to understand reptiles and amphibians because it gives us a chance to actually see what's going on in the wild. So rather than seeing animals in an aquarium or at a zoo, or seeing specimens that were perhaps collected 100 years ago with very little information associated with them. When you go into the field, you can see where the animals are existing now, what they're feeding on. You could also collect DNA from them, which can be so useful for doing genetic work. It could tell us all sorts of things about their how they evolved, but it also can tell us about things like how many there are in a population, and give us also an idea about if there are yet more new species that we haven't seen before. And then of course we can also then take that information, and it tells us a lot about conservation, like for example which species are the most vulnerable to disappearing, to going extinct. They're the ones that we want to make sure of course are protected, because anytime we lose a species in Cuba, then because it's not found anywhere else, it's gone from the whole world, and that means that future generations won't have the chance themselves to see it and to study it. And I think that's, to me, a very sad thing. So I really want to make sure that all the species that we still have in Cuba, that we keep them, we don't lose any more.
Did any snakes bite you? Can any of the snakes kill you?
In Cuba, there are no snakes that can kill you or that are dangerous to human beings. But I have been bitten by some snakes in Cuba, but snakes are so small in Cuba, and for the most part they're so gentle that it happens very rarely, and when it does happen it's almost like a bit of a joke. One of the things that we were doing on our expedition was showing, for example, in schools we were bringing some snakes out and handling them, and some of the children were incredibly brave. They would come forward and then start handling snakes for the first time themselves.
Can crocodiles really leap out of the water?
It's absolutely true that the crocodiles in Cuba do leap, and probably the main reason they're always chasing after food. So for things like these large rodents, these hutias running around in the mangrove swamps, if a Cuban crocodile is sitting there in the water and it sees this juicy meal suddenly coming nearby on the bank, it will jump for it and grab it. But here's the catch, is that that's not special just to Cuban crocodiles. Crocodiles and alligators all over the world can do that.
Are any of the reptiles and amphibians endangered?
There are some species of amphibians and reptiles in Cuba that are endangered. The rock iguana, for example, is a species. It's only found in Cuba, and although it's large, the populations are fairly small. And there's a risk always that some people might try and collect them and sell them as pets, for example. So that's one of the species which is endangered. Also, the sea turtles around Cuba are also protected. The good news is that Cuba has created many protected areas, parks and reserves, and that program is continuing. So there are lots of areas of Cuba now that are being well protected, and which the species that occur there have got a very good chance of their long-term survival.